الحمد لله رب العالمين الصلاة والسلام على خاتم النبيين أما بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ألف لام ميم ذلك الكتاب لا ريب فيه هدى للمتقين الذين يؤمنون بالغيب ويقيمون الصلاة ومما رزقناهم ينفقون والذين يؤمنون بما أنزل إليك وما أنزل من قبلك وبالآخرة هم يوقنون أولئك على هدى من ربهم وأولئك هم المفلحون صدق الله العلي العظيم وصدق رسول النبي الكريم. My dear brothers and sisters, I'm reciting on and its translation, and I'm not a mufassir of Quran that I can do tafsir of this, but I can get only the points to discuss for our tarbiyah and for our concepts and for our clarifications. This is our requirement. Actually, it is not tafsir. There is difference in tafsir and lataif. Latifa means a very delicate thing. So it means that when we recite Quran, so there are verses of Quran, when we translate them or we understand them, so it has clear meaning, but it has some bain sutur things, you know, the things which are hidden under the line. It means when we think about it and we connect different ayat, so we get some new thing, and that thing which is reflecting from the combination of these. So therefore we should get this information, and this becomes very useful, and these are called lataif. So actually we are not doing tafsir of this. It's actually we are picking the points to discuss and to explain the things and concepts. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says alif lam mim. We do not know its meaning. Only Allah knows and Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam knows. And we should not indulge ourselves in this because it has not been told. So therefore we should get it as it is. And we should leave the meaning of these words to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whichever the meanings these have, we are accepting it. But there is one very beautiful concept in this, and I think we should pick that point. For example, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said this in the hadith, that on each harf you get 10 hasanat. And I don't say alif lam mim is single, but it is alif is alone and lam is alone and mim is alone. The example of this has been given, alif lam mim, and it has hasanat. It means ajr we can get from of tilawat, and we do not know the meaning of this. So this gives us the concept that for ajr of tilawat we do not need to you know that the translation, we know tarjuma, because it has not been told. We do not know the meaning, but still we get ajr. So therefore this is a very big, beautiful concept which has been which can be picked from this, that as far as ajr is concerned. But it does not mean that we should not understand tarjuma, understand translation. That is some other issue, and that is required for learning, and that is required for understanding Quran. And the Quran has two types of things involved in it. Number one, it is book of guidance. It is book of guidance. So for that reason, we should learn its meaning, and we should know the concepts in this. For this, we require this. And it is the book of our beloved Allah Subhanahu Wa Taala. So when it is book of our beloved Allah Subhanahu Wa Taala, we should recite it as many times as we can. And we shall not be satisfied even with this, because you know, if letter comes from Mahbub, from beloved, so one is reciting, one is reading it again and again, it's never finished. I know Maulana Uzzurgul Sahib Rahmatullah Alayh, he had a book of Sheikh Ul Hind Rahmatullah Alayh, small book of Sheikh Ul Hind Rahmatullah Alayh, and he was translating, he was reading it again and again. So one person asked him, why you are reading this too much? You have read it too much. So now even you, you may have remembered it. So why you are reading it again and again? He says, I'm talking with Shaykh Walid because of this. So it means it is actually the talking of talking with the beloved. So therefore, Hazrat Ali Karamullah said, "See, when I need to talk to Allah Subhanahu wa Taala, I pray, I offer prayer, and when I want to listen from Allah Subhanahu wa Taala, then I read Quran." So these are ayahs. These are ayahs. So it means actually our salat is our lisan for Allah Subhanahu wa Taala. And Quran, we have to listen, and we should use ears in this. So therefore, we should get the concept from this word alif lam mim, which is a very beautiful concept. Now, zalikal kitabu la rayba fi hudan lil muttaqin. This book has no doubt in it, a guidance for the God fearing. It has no doubt. Maybe the people have doubts. But actually, what they are doing, it's they are reading it with the eyes of their nafs, with the eyes of their wrong concepts, with the eyes of, you can say, lack of knowledge. They read it, so therefore they don't understand. But if a person uses those things which are required for this, so my God, it will be guidance for that. And the special thing for guidance is this, that one should have good heart. Because taqwa is in the good heart. Here it is taqwa, which has been explained that we should be having God, for the people God fearing. And that is taqwa. As far as taqwa is concerned, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّ فِي ذَلِكَ لَذِكْرَ لِمَنْ كَانَ لَهُ قَلْبٌ. Indeed, in Quran there is a lesson for people, for those people who have heard, you know, who have real heart, which can understand. So this has been told. So it means if we have good heart, and that heart is not having love of dunya, so that will be understanding Quran. So it means taqwa. In Rasulullah SAW said taqwa ha huna, taqwa ha huna. And ashara al-qalb. Rasulullah SAW said taqwa is here, taqwa is here, taqwa, and pointed the heart. So it means we should use the taqwa of our heart, of talib salim, to understand Quran. So that's why we should not only think about the words, but we should be working upon our hearts. You know, if a thing is coming in the telephone, and your telephone has a not good reception, it does not have. So will you listen that? You will not be able to listen because you don't have reception. So it means the saying tongue is required, and for listening, ear is required. So those people who have ears of this category of taqwa, of having taqwa, so then they will be understanding Quran, subhanallah. But who are muttaqeen? So the best definition is coming from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that is, الَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْغَيْبِ وَيُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةَ وَمِمَّا رَزَقْنَاهُمْ يُنْفِقُونَ. Who believe in the unseen and are steadfast in salat, prayer, and spend out of what we have provided them. So these two actions have been, narrated, that these two actions they must have been doing. And what are these? Number one, they should be offering prayer. They should not lose the prayer. Because one person cannot be muttaqi if he is not offering prayer. That he cannot be. Because I cannot define anything by myself if it has been defined by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I should stick to that definition. I don't have the authority of defining the things which are religious things, which are Islamic things. I am not authorized to define the things my own. It is actually the definitions which are coming from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We have to stick to those definitions. So taqwa is also a term which is coming from Quran and which is coming from Hadith. So therefore we have to go to Quran and Sunnah for this concern to understand what is taqwa. So one thing is coming from here, from this verse. Allazina yu'minuna bil ghaib. Those people who believe in unseen things. See the beauty in this. What is that? You know, when I see myself, so actually I am depending upon my eyes. And if I am seeing through eyes of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the beloved of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so it means something else. I have to follow the guidance from coming from there. Hazrat Khadijah al-Kubra radiallahu ta'ala when was informed about the condition of his son who died by Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, told her, if you want, I can ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to show you your son in Jannah. And Khadijah al-Kubra radiallahu ta'ala said, now I don't need it because I don't trust on my eyes. Eyes that much, I trust upon you, upon your words. So how beautiful it is. It means if something is coming in Quran, if something is coming from the tongues of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, why should I not believe? I should believe in these things. I should not define the things my own. I should believe in those things which are unseen. These are unseen for us, not for Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam has seen all these things because he went to Miraj Sharif and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala showed him all these things. And when he started to work on his nation, Arab, so he asked this question, if I say to you, there's some enemy on the other side of the mountain and that may attack upon you, will you believe in this? So they all said, why not to believe? Because we have found you from Amin and Sadiqeen. You are Amin and Sadiq. So therefore we should believe in you. And then Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam told them that you should believe in one Allah and not the idols or something like this. So it means he presented himself before them to trust upon. And this presentation was not so simple. I cannot do this because I don't have the capacity of this. He had the capacity because he lived for 40 years among them and showing all the things we claim for the good things in his body and soul. And they trusted upon it. Therefore, he presented himself that whether you will believe in this or not. So they said, we believe, we have to believe. So it means to believe in unseen things, actually it is to believe in those things seen by Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Actually is this. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala seen it himself too much, of course. It is actually, we believe in this, that the things seen by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we believe in this. Actually it is not unseen things, actually. These are the things seen by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and we have to believe in them because Allah is subhan and Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is sadiq. So therefore we have to believe in this. وَالَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِمَا أُنزِلَ إِلَيْكَ وَمَا أُنزِلَ مِن قَبْلِكَ وَبِالْآخِرَةِ هُمْ يُوقِنُونَ. And who believe in what has been revealed to you and what has been revealed before you, and they have faith in the life hereafter. Subhanallah. Actually, in this it has been told. Actually, in this verse, all wahi which was coming before Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and coming to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam has to be accepted, has to be believed. So actually, everything which is coming from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through proper channel, so it has to be believed. So وَالَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِمَا أُنزِلَ إِلَيْكَ وَمَا أُنزِلَ مِنْ قَبْلِكَ وَبِالْآخِرَةِ هُمْ يُوقِنُونَ. And especially we should focus upon the last words, وَبِالْ آخِرَةِ هُمْ يُوْكِنُونَ, because in this it has been said to they have faith in akhirah. It means the life hereafter, they have faith. Actually, this yaqeen is coming through akal, through mind. And iman is coming through heart. So if heart of mu'min sees or hears something about those things revealed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to Rasulullah and before, they accepted. This is iman. But in akhirat, they have to be dead sure about this. They should know, they should have no doubt. They should know, they should have no problem in understanding this. It should be very clear that akhirat is there. And through the conceptually we have to understand it. So this is actually bil akhiratum yuqinun. So there are three stages. One is ilmul yaqeen, and the second is you can say ainul yaqeen, and third is haqqul yaqeen. So we have to get these things. And after that, what will be present? What will be there? We shall be acting upon the instructions of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make our life hereafter better. Our intention will be all different. Now we are thinking about the worldly things, that I should get this and I should get this and I should get this. Okay. As a normal people, we can do this. But if we have iman, and that iman has convinced our mind to bring yaqeen in that, so after that, that will change our whole setup of our thinking. Our thinking pattern will get changed. This is actually important. So this thinking pattern should be changed. It is not simple, the words, it's not the simple words. It's actually the thinking pattern. We should be thinking like how Sahaba were thinking. We should be thinking like Anbiya, they were thinking. You can say we should be thinking about those things which are in the life hereafter to get more and more in that. This is very important. So then our whole life will be changed. We shall be then, what will be doing, we shall be then thinking about how can I can get hasanat? How can I can please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? How can I love Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? How can I get, good, I have to be in good books of them. How can I do this? This will be actually the thinking. This is very important. So if we get this, so really that iman will be very, very, you can say, standard iman, just like Sahaba. Haji? So you can say, we should act upon this. So therefore, Hazrat Shah Waliullah Rahmatullah Alayhi explained this thing in his book Al-Thaf Al-Quds, to work upon three things. Number one, nafs, to train it. Number two, heart, to clean it. And number three, or third, aqal, mind, to purify and to connect it with sir, Malai Allah, to get information from them, and then depending upon them to decide the things. This is required. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us tawfiq to have this tarbiyat in this direction, that our heart is cleaned, our nafs is trained, and our akal mind is purified, and thinking in better way. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us tawfiq of following those paths to achieve these goals. وَمَا عَلَيْنَا إِلَّا الْبَلَاغُ.